Hello. Well, I will start by sharing some thoughts about strategies for increasing access to phenotyping tools. So we've been talking a lot about affordable phenotyping. So what do people understand when they talk about affordable? Well, something that has a low cost, especially a product, a low-cost product. And we have been working about this since the first time I came to Jülich in 2011. We were one of the few people talking about low-cost phenotyping tools. And well, in 2014 we were still advocating for low-cost phenotyping tools to widen the access to phenotyping tools so that more people could have access to this technology. So basically our idea was that the users can have access to an expensive product because there's a barrier. Yeah, that is the cost. So, if you have an affordable product, then many users will get access to that technology. And to use a metaphor, it would be like, imagine you go on holiday to Argentina, and you want to go to the Andes Mountains, and you find this, a nice, straight road to get where you want to go. But did it work like that? Well, we made an affordable product, but the first thing we got was that the user said, well, it's low cost. Does it work? Maybe it's low cost, low quality. So we had to test it. And, well, not only test it, we had to publish it in a peer-reviewed journal so that researchers would believe us. And then we only had an article. We need to find someone that could build that platform and sell it and get to the user. So now we have a lot of steps. And if we have a lot of steps, then it means that we have a lot of barriers. Cost is not the only barrier. We can have more things to overcome. And also, we need to not only focus on the low-cost product. We have to think of this as a process to get the technology to the final users. And of course, this was one case. Surely there can be different paths depending on what kind of technology to get that technology to the users. And of course you will get feedback and you get your technology to the user and the user says, well, that's not what I need. So you go back. So it's not only a process, but it's a very complex process. So going back to our metaphor, maybe what we will find something more like this. It's not a road trip, but an exploration hike into an unknown terrain, and we need to learn things like how to find the best path to get where we want to go. Maybe, I don't know, how to make fire, and maybe we wouldn't want to go alone on this trip. So since it's a complex process, what we learn is that learning is very important. We need to ask ourselves, what are the different possible paths? What are the steps required to get where we want to go? What are the possible barriers? And, for example, can we learn from successful stories. And also, to tackle all these questions, we need diverse capabilities, diverse views, diverse actors, approaches, etc. So going back to our title about strategies, now Luis will talk about what strategies.
So what I will tell you what we have done, mainly what we have learned and what we plan to do. So as Gustavo told you, our first idea was that a low-cost platform was necessary to increase access to plant phenotyping. So we built it. And this is the GLIF platform. And now we have a prototype which has been largely improved. But the first prototype was built on 2011, and now the product is not yet on the market. So we think that failure could be a success if we learn from it. So we have learned several things. For instance, that low cost for somebody could represent a high cost for other, and vice versa. And adoption of technology depends on cost, but also of benefits. So we can, there are a concept that is low cost, but other one, what is still better, is cost effective. So a thing that is costly could give you a lot of benefits. For instance, for selecting a trait at our center, what do we do? Because the benefit of a phenotyping trait could depend of different criteria, not only of the cost for measuring it. For instance, a good correlation with the target parameters, a high repeatability, the earliness, how early it could be measured. So we phenotype different traits in our platform. We evaluate this trait and the different criteria. We identificate candidate traits, those that are good under these different criteria. We select from independent genotypes from field trials, and we phenotype in these different genotypes the candidate traits in GLIF to identify which are the better traits. We have also learned that the low-cost product is frequently perceived by people as a low-quality product. So in such context is benchmarking of phenotyping device and tools is essential. During our last day in Jülich, we performed a benchmarking of different of user cameras, thermal cameras, and more sophisticated one. And tomorrow, you will perform a benchmarking, similar work, of thermal cameras in one of the hands-on activities. So I invite you to participate in this activity. Also, we learned that the classic model, which we applied for the low-cost platform GLIF, that is patenting and licensing is not the only one. Using open source hardware or software is, for instance, another possibility. And we use this approach with better results. For instance, to develop an UAV platform for film phenotyping for wheat and soybean based on open source hardware and software for Latin America. We also learned that we need to take in account the demand, what is needed. So we experienced this during an agreement we performed with Syngenta France, during which we established an UAV-based field platform for phenotyping drought tolerance in sunflower. And during this work, we work in the experimental sites of the company in different regions of Argentina. And what was very interesting that we learned what the breeders demanded in a real breeding program, working in a real breeding program. We also learned that there are a diverse need of phenotyping tools, not only for breeding, but also for basic research on plant science. And for instance, an example, Phenotiki, we think is a very interesting tool, and we have present it in some workshop in Argentina at a Latin American scale. Finally, we learned that we need to create a structure allowing to respond this wide range of demands in Argentina, but also in Mercosur, our common market, and Latin America. So we are creating a phenomic center at Balcarce, where we work, devoted to make services, research, education, mainly development of phenomic tools to support the needs on phenotyping of the different regions of our country. You know, Argentina is a country with different environments, so different agricultural productions and a high potential from a bioeconomy point of view. So our project is to build a national phenotyping center with different centers devoted to phenotyping different agricultural productions, different sub-centers, but all this system will be supported by a center devoted to support the development, education, to have people with different skills and the human resource we need, services, research, and mainly development to develop tools for the different needs. And the focus of the center will be on the process involved in technology adoption. Our Ministry of Science has yet made available the 25% of the budget for creating this center. So finally, the strategy for widening the adoption of phenotyping technologies are multiple. And the adoption of phenotyping technology is a complex and non-linear process. Learning from successful examples, but also from failures, and involving a wide range of disciplines and actors are key to widening access for phenotyping. We at CENAIF and in our center, we will carry out activities toward this goal in Argentina and Latin America. But the working group on affordable phenotyping could play a key role, we think, in expanding access to phenotyping globally. So thank you very much.